In this session, we will look at Lev Semyonovich Vygotsky and his idea of cognitive psychology, language, culture, community, and the process of teaching learning. Vygotsky was born in 1896, the same year Piaget was born, but he had a very short life, 37 years. He died in 1934. He became an avant-garde writer, had a lot of interest in poetry, literature, philosophy, humanities in general, and there is no doubt, in many respects, Vygotsky was far ahead of his time, which is so rare in history. The scope and originality of his writings, considering the period in which he wrote, was very remarkable. In 1917, October Revolution took place in Russia, and most of the developments which took place in Vygotsky's career spawn between 1924 and 1934. So, historical contribution on individual development, genetic conception of genetic phenomenon, which was never touched by the Western psychologists. Vygotsky studied law, philosophy, and history at Moscow in 1912. He had an excellent training in humanities, languages, linguistics, aesthetics, etc. At the age of 20, he wrote a voluminous treatise on Hamlet. He had interest in poetry, drama, language, questions of science and meaning, theory of literature, cinema, the issues of history, etc., etc. And before he began his research in psychology, he wrote a book, The Psychology of Art, in 1925. Similar thing was done by Piaget. He was born in the same year. He was interested in biology, but later he became a psychologist, cognitive psychologist. Vygotsky stressed the contribution of culture, social interaction, and the historical dimension of mental development. He also worked very closely with the handicapped children, and that gave him the ambience to look at the various issues related to language acquisition, interaction of the individual with society, and the implications for this kind of interaction for education. In 1924, he did something in Moscow Institute of Psychology, and that had implications for his later work. The essential writing and professional activities of Vygotsky belong to this period, which of course was long neglected, but now surfacing both in Russia and elsewhere. Vygotsky's most important work, Thought and Language, was published only in 1962. His complete works are being prepared for publication perhaps sooner. The texts of Vygotsky are in Russian language, and he invented a terminology that was capable of expressing the new approach he adopted. Any translation of his works runs the risk of distorting those ideas. We can think of the terms like ahimsa, dharma, hartal, satyagraha, which are of specific Indian origin. If anyone wants to translate the concept of dharma to the Western audience, there will be a lot of problems. Whereas in the Indian context, it is understood across the languages, similarly with ahimsa. So, in Russian language, what Vygotsky wrote has a richer connotation and deeper understanding, which perhaps is a challenge to the translators of Vygotsky from Russian to any other language in the world. His thinking is concerned about the methodology of science, general psychology, psychology of art, and the problems faced by the handicapped children. He invented terminology that was capable of expressing his new approach in a specific Russian situation in a Russian language, but they are generalizable. Vygotsky's theory on mental ontogenesis and his educational ideas and the applications of these ideas in educational research and everyday teaching practice are extremely important. Vygotsky's theory talks about human sociability, social interaction, sign and instrument, culture, history, and high mental functions. It's a single formula. If we have to express Vygotsky's thought in a single formula, it can be expressed like this. Socio-historico-cultural theory of the development of higher mental functions. Now, this can be unpacked in great detail, but considering the time constraint, now I will only mention a few of this. The human being is characterized primarily by sociability. Henry Wallen, another psychologist, also holds the same view. The individual is genetically social. This principle was purely theoretical hypothesis. Today, an established scientific fact. During the time of Vygotsky, nobody understood the implications of his thought for education outside the Soviet Union. In the Soviet Union, he was extremely popular and extremely important even for the political leaders like Joseph Stalin and others. His ideas talked about the convergence of two currents of research: biological research that concerns the individual development and the research on social development, particularly in the earliest childhood. But then these are not two distinct categories. They are intertwined. It is through the mediation of the adult that the child undertakes activities. Absolutely everything in the behavior of the child is merged and rooted in social relations. Thus, the child's relations with reality are from the start social relations. So, the newborn baby cannot be said as a complete individual. The baby could be said to be in the highest degree a social being. It's obviously very, very revolutionary idea. The sociability of children is the basis for their social interactions. Human beings in general can neither exist nor develop in the normal way for their species as isolated nomads. In isolation, they are not complete beings. They become social beings because of their interaction with the immediate family, with the neighborhood, with the community, with society at large. Now, this has a lot of implications. Anyone who studies the human behavior by isolating that individual from the family setting, from the community, from the culture, from society at large, runs the risk of distorting the understanding of development. So that's the most significant contribution of Vygotsky. Even a baby, while looking at the mother, demonstrates that the baby is not an individual in isolation of society, but a social being. Without the interaction between the baby and the mother, or the parents, or the neighborhood, it's impossible for the child to attain any kind of development all alone. We are all familiar with the story of that wolf boy. A child was carried away by a wolf, and the child, a male child, lived up to 5 years in the company of the wolves. After 5 years, when the child was discovered by others, they found that his behavior was not at all human, and he could not acquire any language after the 5th year. So this tells that unless the baby or any individual interacts with his or her own human society, it is not possible either to acquire language or education or to develop anything that we call development. Higher mental functions, such as deliberate attention, logical memory, verbal and conceptual thought, and complex emotions could not emerge and take form in the development process without the constructive assistance of social interaction. It's an extremely important statement, particularly in the context of India. We talk about intellectual attainments. We talk about inclusive society. We talk about an equalitarian or egalitarian and a society of equality. When we think particularly of so many divisions within the social setup, and we also talk about education of for all and education of all. We have a right to education bill, and we also have our constitution. We have reservation policies. We have the definition of our society as a socialist, secular, democratic republic. All these words may sound very attractive, but when it comes to attaining these principles, these goals, you meet with all kinds of challenges. For example, how many languages are there in India? Right now, we can identify at least 1,652 major and minor languages put together. And we have thousands of castes, 6,000 plus. And we have 22 major languages included in the 8th schedule. And we have English as medium of instruction, perhaps the sole medium of instruction at the higher education level, barring a few exceptions, where the mother tongue is the medium of instruction. Now, in this kind of situation, when we think about developing higher mental functions, we need to take the help of Vygotsky to understand first the problem and then to think of a solution. Let me just take one example, the reservation. Reservation for the underprivileged people, whom we call scheduled castes and scheduled tribes, or the minorities. What is their background? How much exposure they had before they made an application, either to the universities or the centers of excellence like IITs or IIMs, and with whom they compete, and what kind of opportunities they had earlier. Now, what is the prior knowledge they have to compete with these people? When you study all this, then you begin to understand where the problem lies. It is not the fault of a child born in an underprivileged community if that child cannot compete with the privileged children. So, it throws light on the unseen or unrecognized social inequalities. And if the social inequalities cannot be reconciled, then what kind of education will become an inclusive education? These are some of the questions which need to be raised. Answers can be many, but at least one has to raise these questions before we find answers. And that's why I see a lot of importance, lot of significance in Vygotsky's writings. The relationship between thought and language has to be understood in this context. The child's capacity to acquire a language is strongly determined by heredity. Now, what do we mean by heredity? Take for example, an educated family which has generations of their forefathers having access to education. It becomes almost genetic. So, the skills, language skill and other educational skill are passed on from generation to generation, irrespective of their economic status. Now, this is something which is extremely important when we talk about educational equality. It is not just the economic status that can really give that kind of advantage to a child. A community may be economically very well off, but if that community did not have the intellectual tradition or the continuity of generations old educational opportunities, then that community remains educationally backward. And in contemporary India, we need to recognize this. Suddenly a community can become rich, but that community cannot have a sudden attainment of education or fine arts or any other aspects of culture unless programs are deliberately planned and then implemented over a period of time. And take the other case, even if a particular community has the advantage of having higher order mental skills, it is not sufficient condition to continue, because at any time that superiority or that comfort level may degenerate due to other social factors. A contribution from the social environment in the form of a quite specific type of teaching process, constructing in common during activities involving the child and the adult, will be very, very important. It is a social interaction. Language as an instrument of social relations is transformed into an instrument of internal psychic organization for the child. Let me think of some concrete examples. Take, for example, the school system in India. We have government schools. We have public schools in a city like Delhi, Delhi Public School, and you have private schools. It's very interesting that the public schools in Delhi are actually private schools, and the private schools in general are supported by very rich communities or industry, and the government schools are the ones which have very limited resources to fend for themselves. And in all this, we have either mother tongue or English as the language which transports all the educational content, which carries the message to the students. Now, what is the current thinking? The current thinking is that unless children get the best quality education, then they become unemployable, unfit, and therefore the education goes waste. Now, how to improve this situation? How to change this situation? When a language is taught, whether it is mother tongue or English, what kind of social relations determine the quality of teaching? After completing 8th class, if a government school child cannot formulate a single correct sentence, either in Hindi or in English, what is the value, what is the worth of that language education? And at the same time, in public schools and in private schools, if English is the sole medium of instruction, and if it is taught well through a single practice, a single task of language teaching, we make all the difference between the government school children and the private school or public school children. The privileged ones get the public school education or education through private schools. The less privileged ones go to government schools. Now, the things are changing now, thanks to the reports submitted by annual educational surveys and debates in the parliament, debates in the educational circles. Government schools are showing a lot of improvement. Now, what do we understand? Personally, I feel if language education, language instruction is given the uniform attention, it hardly matters whether the child goes to a private school or a government school. And my own hypothesis is, if India has to become a knowledge power, then the process must start with the acquisition of language. And the language policy has to be at least twofold. The mother tongue and English, which is the window to the world, window to acquire the knowledge of the entire world today, must be given equal importance, must be taught well, and children should be allowed to interact with each other in both the languages. And then after some time, once they get the necessary competence in using both the languages, they can compete anywhere. They may come in very ordinary uniforms. Poor children can compete, and they are competing wherever they get an opportunity. Now, this is an insight which I developed after going through Vygotsky's social interaction as the basis of language acquisition, and by extension, it is the real development. We all know that the modern economic theories look at education as development, and that development can take place only through education if it is taught through a language which gives them all the necessary learning resources. So the new acquisition, such as language, are of social origin to interact with other mental functions such as thought. So there can't be a thought without a representation through language. And Vygotsky's hypothesis can be summed up in this manner. The crucial factor in development is not the progress of each function considered separately, but the changing relationship between different functions such as logical, memory, verbal thought, and so forth, that consists of development. And development consists of the formation of composite functions, systems of functions, systemic functions, and functional systems. The role of adults as representatives of the culture in children's language acquisition, in their assimilation as part of the culture, the role of mother tongue, all play an important role. A new type of interaction besides social interaction becomes necessary, and that's why we have the arrangement for schools to impart education. And education is termed as the artificial development. But without this artificial development, real development cannot take place. And that is Vygotsky's firm belief. The interaction with the products of culture is very important. Socio-cultural interaction, Marx also talked about the individual's non-organic body and the individual's link with the society. Culture forms an integral part of the individual, but it's nevertheless outside him, and therefore you have to have a connection. If that connection is not there, the real development will not take place. Hence, the development of a person cannot be reduced solely to the changes taking place within the individual, because that is the focus of the behaviorists. And the cognitive psychologists challenge that, most of all by Vygotsky. Series of tools directed towards themselves, the children can use them to control, master, and develop their own capacities. These tools include spoken and written language. Without the language, then you cannot express your thought. Now, it is very important to learn the language and acquire mastery of language and also mastery of content. The children must be aware of the rituals, models of behavior depicted in works of art, systems of scientific concepts, techniques, etc., etc., in one's own culture, in one's own history. And these will help them to improve their understanding, not only of their own being, their own society, but to master their own language. the acquisition of systems of scientific concepts. The most important acquisition during the period when a child is in school is the system of scientific concepts as a cultural tool for profound messages and its assimilation by children. This exposure induces profound changes in their mode of thought. Essential property of scientific concepts is their structure, the fact that they are organized in hierarchical systems. We know very well that at different periods in Indian history, we excelled in different branches of knowledge. But there are also periods of history where the achievements were simply forgotten and people did not have a vital link. But look at the continuity of that kind of culture, for example, in modern Europe or in the Western world. There is a continuity, and therefore a child, even at the age of 14 or 15, can acquire mastery over the language, over the content, over the concepts, and then contribute much more significantly than children born in societies, in countries where this kind of opportunity is missing. I will just give one example and then close this session. Einstein, who was thought to be a dull student till he completed his school finals, completed reading and understanding almost the entire Western philosophy when he was just 16. And he knew whatever was available by way of scientific literature, starting from Aristotle to Newton, Galileo, Copernicus, and all his contemporaries. And then he came out with this theory of relativity. Now, how it happened? It is the organic connection, the vital link with Einstein's own intellectual and cultural traditions that helped Einstein to become Einstein. Thank you.